the name of Allah, our Creator, the Creator of the universe and of everything that's in it, I greet you all in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings, and mercy be with you all. Dear viewers, this episode is entitled Scientific Notions in the Glorious Quran. And before talking about the Glorious Quran, I would like to emphasize the fact that this is the only form of divine guidance that has been kept within the hands of man for more than 14 centuries in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of the Creator, word to word and letter to letter. This is the last form of divine guidance to man. And because of this, Allah has taken the responsibility to preserve it in its entirety. And the mere preservation of the glorious Quran for that long span of time, and the divine decree is that it will be preserved until the end of this world. This preservation is one of the most prominent miracles of that book. And the glorious Quran is the final integration of the divine guidance to man that was given to Adam and Eve, may Allah be pleased with them both, on the moment of their creation, and was revealed to a large number of prophets and messengers of Allah over a very long span of time. And there had to be a final, a full stop to that process of divine guidance. The glorious Quran is the only form of divine guidance to man that has been kept intact in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of the Creator, word to word and letter to letter. Being the last form of divine guidance, it has to be kept by a divine promise. And the mere preservation of the Quran for that long lapse of time is one of its greatest miracles. And one may ask, does the Quran contain any scientific notions? And to answer this, I have to emphasize the fact that the glorious Quran is basically a book of guidance to man in areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man, such as the area of faith, the area of acts of worship, the area of the moral code, and the area of the code of transactions with others. And if we look into each of these four basic areas that constitute the basic foundations of any divine revelation, we can see clearly that these four basic areas cannot be clearly addressed by man. First of all, the area of faith. In this area, we are asked to believe in Allah, our Creator, the Creator of the universe and of everything that's in it. And we do not see Him. We see the wonders of His creation, but we cannot see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so long our souls are imprisoned, that flesh in that body, in that earthly body. We hope to see Him in Akhirah, inshallah, in paradise. But so long we are living in this world, we cannot see Allah. Yet we are asked to believe in Him. And we are asked to believe in His supremacy above all His creation. So Allah, the Creator of this universe and of everything that's in it, is above space and time, above matter and energy. Nothing of His creation looks like Him. And the basic rule in Islam is that you must exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above all His creation. Yet we are asked to believe also in His angels, and we cannot see them. And unless the Quran has told us that Allah has created a certain creation called angels, we could have never found any proof to prove or disprove the existence of angels. We are asked to believe in the spirit that has blown by Allah in every individual of the human race. And nobody can know what's the type, what's the nature of that spirit. We are asked to believe in the jinn, and we cannot see them. We are asked to believe in a special existence in the grave, Hayatul Barzakh. And no dead man has come back to tell us his experience. We are asked to believe in resurrection after death, in accountability, in judgment, in eternity, in life to come. And we have no material or physical evidence to prove or disprove the reality of these facts. Unless Allah has given us the guidance in these areas, in the area of faith, man could never ever be on a true faith. And people who do not believe in the true faith, their faith will be thrown into their faces on the day of judgment, regardless of the fact that they were faithful to it or not. The second basic foundation of religion is the acts of worship. And worship, by definition, is obedience. And there can never be any obedience without the divine guidance. I cannot innovate a set of acts of worship for myself and assume that these will be accepted by my Creator. Worship, by definition, means submission in obedience. And unless I receive that guidance from my Creator, my worship can never be accepted. Whether I have done it properly or not, it will never be accepted. The third basic foundation of religion is the moral code. And we know that all forms of divine guidance invite for high level of morality, for the excellence of morality. Yet, although man is a moral being by creation, yet he cannot establish for himself or herself a moral code that can be absolutely correct and absolutely unbiased. So even the moral code has to be absolutely divinely revealed. If we leave the moral code to man to tailor, he can either make it too tight to be impossible or too lax to be useless. And we can see many examples of the human communities that are living currently by their own standards, how much deviation they have fallen into. And the fourth basic foundation of religion is the code of transactions with others. And we see that because of the human selfishness, because of the human greed, because of the human aspiration for the better and their fear of the future, human relationship without divine guidance can entail lots of injustices. And that's why we can see clearly that man cannot live peacefully, happily, and successfully on the surface of that planet without divine guidance. And at the same time, that divine guidance can never be tailored by man. And if we accept this argument, we can find a clear-cut criterion by which we can discriminate between a true religion and a false one. And this criterion is the authenticity of the revelation that was sent down with that divine guidance. If the revelation is intact, in exactly the same language of revelation, has not been tampered by the human infiltrations, and at the same time, man cannot live peacefully, happily, and successfully on the surface of that planet without the divine guidance. If we accept this argument, we can find a clear-cut criterion by which we can discriminate between a true religion and a false one. And this criterion is the authenticity of the revelation that was sent down with the religion. If the revelation is intact, in exactly the same language of revelation, has not been tampered by human infiltrations, has not been played around by man, has not been transferred to another language and infiltrated by human ideas, then the religion is correct. If the authentic revelation has been lost and has been committed to another language, has been reinterpreted by man, has been infiltrated by human ideas, the religion can never be correct. Whether somebody would be committed to it or not, whether a large flock of people would be believing in it or not, it will never be accepted by Allah. Following this argument, we can see a clear-cut criterion by which we can discriminate between a true religion and a false one. And this criterion is the authenticity of the revelation that was sent down with the religion. If the revelation is intact, the religion is correct. If the revelation has been lost, the religion can never be correct, even if it still contains some signs of that initial or some remnants of that initial truth. If we apply this criterion to all the isms of the time, we can see clearly that the only form of divine guidance with man that has been kept intact in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of Allah, word to word and letter to letter, is the glorious Quran and the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him. So it becomes obvious to us that the message of the Quran is the divine guidance to man in these four basic areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man: faith, acts of worship, the moral code, and the code of transactions with others. If we accept that, why do we talk about the scientific notions in the Quran? If we read the Quran, we can see clearly that beside this basic message, the four basic foundations of religion, we can find many examples from the universe, from the earth, the moon, the sun, the solar system, the constellations. And we would wonder why these scientific notions are included in the Quran. I will stop here and I will continue, inshallah, with this topic after a short break. And then after the break, I will come back to you to explain why the Quran contains more than 1,000 verses that are related to our universe. Dear viewers, after this short break, I come back to you with the answer to the basic question of this episode, scientific notions in the glorious Quran, and to answer the question, does the Quran contain any scientific notions and why? If we read the glorious Quran, we can see very clearly that amidst the main message of the Quran, which is faith, acts of worship, the moral code, and the code of transactions with others, we can find many notifications about many things of the universe, many things of the cosmos we are living in, talking about the earth, the moon, the sun, the solar system, the planets, the constellations, every messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had enough material miracles that can testify to his prophethood or his messengerhood. And these miracles were mainly from amidst what the people of that prophet has excelled. So Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, came at a time when magic was at a climax. So Allah gave him enough knowledge to nullify the work of the magicians. Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, was sent down at a time when medical treatment was at a climax. And that's why Allah gave him enough knowledge to excel the medical doctors of his time. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came at a time when the main area of excellence of the Arabs was eloquence, the excellence of speech. And that's why Allah gave him the Quran to challenge the Arab at that peak of excellence, of eloquence, to produce a chapter like it, a surah like it, or even 10 surahs like it, or a book like it. And the Arabs at that peak of excellence could not face that challenge. And this challenge is still there up until our time. And no sane person could stand up and say that, yes, I could produce a surah like the many surahs in the Quran. Because of this, the area of excellence of the Arabs was eloquence, and the Quran came to challenge them to produce a single surah of the Quran, single chapter of the Quran, and they failed to do that. So this was a convincing evidence to the prophethood of Muhammad, peace be upon him. And Allah has told us in the glorious Quran that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the seal of that long chain of prophets and messengers sent by God, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the guidance of man. And Allah, out of his mercy and justice, said, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. We were not to punish without sending a messenger. And Prophet Muhammad is the seed of that long chain of prophets and messengers. No prophet or messenger can come after Muhammad, peace be upon him. So Allah has taken the responsibility to preserve his message in its entirety so that this message can remain the living evidence, the living miracle that can prove the prophethood of Muhammad, peace be upon him, and can testify for the divine nature of the glorious Quran. Allah knows in his eternal knowledge that time will come when man will develop in the area of science and technology as he developed before. And man will be conceited with his scientific and technological achievements. And whenever you ask him to believe in God, to believe in Allah, to believe in the Creator, to believe in his messengers, in his angels, in his books, he will ask for the scientific evidence. Because of this, Allah in his glory has infilled the glorious Quran with many scientific facts, many scientific notions that do not come to man as pieces of scientific information per se. All these notions come in the context of testifying to the might, knowledge, and wisdom of the Creator, to testify to the fact that inasmuch as Allah has created, he can annihilate what he has created and can resurrect everything again. And the area of resurrection has been highly debated by heathens, agnostics, and unbelievers. It can also testify to the fact that the Quran cannot be the work of man. For a book revealed more than 14 centuries ago to an unlettered prophet in an unlettered society to come up with many of the scientific facts that were only disclosed to man a few decades ago is the scientific miracle of the glorious Quran. And because of this, I dare say that the scientific notions in the glorious Quran are an address to the people of our time. You people of science and technology, here is a book revealed more than 14 centuries ago to an unlettered prophet in an unlettered society. And this book contains an immense quantity of scientific facts that were only revealed to man a few decades ago. And this scientific precedence is what we call the scientific miracle in the glorious Quran. And because of this, we can understand why the Quran, a book of divine guidance to man in areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man, such as the area of faith, the area of acts of worship, the area of the moral code, and the area of the code of transactions with others, this book contains that immense amount of scientific notions, and these scientific notions were used in the past to testify to the might, knowledge, and will of the Creator, to testify to the fact that the Creator has got the capacity to annihilate his creation and to resurrect everything again. And to our time, or to the people of our time, these scientific notions are an address to our people in the only language they can understand, which is the scientific language. Because of this, I think it has become an obligation on every Muslim in every discipline to read the glorious Quran and to look for the notions in his or her area of specialization and try to analyze these notions in the light of the scientific facts of the time. And by this, we can first of all understand the Quran, which was sent down to us to and to be understood. And secondly, we can use this understanding to prove to ourselves and to others as well the precedence of the Quran with an immense quantity of scientific facts that can easily testify to the prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and to testify to every rational person that the Quran cannot be the work of man. It is the divine word in its divine purity. And this scientific address is the most suitable language to the people of our time. Because of this, I started this wonderful program, Islam and Science, by this introduction on scientific notions in the glorious Quran. And I will emphasize again that the glorious Quran is basically a book of guidance to man in areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man, such as the area of faith, the area of acts of worship, the area of the moral code, and the area of the code of transactions with others. Within this great message of the Quran, we find more than 1,000 cosmic verses, and these cosmic verses have to be clearly understood by Muslims because the Quran came down to us to understand it. These cosmic verses in the past and in the present as well come to testify to the fact that this vast, immense, orderly universe must have a creator, and this creator has to be exalted above all his creation. Neither space nor time can delimit his identity, neither matter nor energy can shape that identity. And all what we know about this creator is that nothing in his creation can look like him. I started this program by this notion, which explains why a book of divine guidance to man contains that immense quantity of cosmic verses. And in the coming episode, inshallah, we can elaborate on the same thing in the sayings of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is quoted to have said, "Utitu al-Qur'ana wa mithlahu ma'a," I was given the Quran and the similar of it with it. And the sayings of Muhammad, peace be upon him, are part of the divine revelation. It does not rank to the level of the Quran, but it came from the same source. And until that time, I plead to Allah to bless you all and accept our and your work in the way of convincing others with the truth, and the only truth within hands of man today, Islam, as finally integrated in the message of Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Quran and in the traditions of that prophet. And until the other episode would come, I leave you with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with Islamic greeting, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings, and mercy be with you all.